I believe each of you have had a chance to look at the headlines in the papers. Nothing new this morning. It's been the big story for the last couple of days. Let's see how each daily chose to capture it. On the front page of the Daily Nation, Ruto aide caught in dams scandal probe. Investigations show that an insurance firm associated with the deputy president's chief of staff received 47 million shillings from an Italian firm at the center of a 21 billion shilling scam, say detectives, as the money trail involves other companies associated with Kenya's bigwigs takes shape. And you can get the full story on page 2. Big shots caught up in dams scam as the money trail emerges. While on the front page of the Standard, kickback probe, 4 billion Kenya shillings cash was taken. Detectives who have already questioned a CS now probing how 4 billion of the 6.3 billion paid to the Italian company before the dams project started was wired back to Kenya and quickly cashed at a bank's branch in Nairobi's Westlands. This reads like the front page of a thriller that could sell for a lot of money anywhere around the world.
Titled Grand Heist.
Grand Heist. That's how you title it, Trevor. I don't know how my guests would title it, but I want to get the opinion now. Honorable Midiwo, let me start with you. Let me get your thoughts on this. And many are asking questions. How did this happen? How did so much, something like this happen of such magnitude? And yet, again, Kenyans find themselves having lost money, taxes, etc.
Well, I think, Hege, that these things have always happened. I'm so happy to leave this moment. At least now we are catching them. I think we need to talk. How do we get positive results out of such negative occurrences? You know, this Italian company does not have an office in Nairobi. It does not have even a lawyer in Nairobi. It has no local content. So this whole thing was meant for theft. Nobody intended to build a dam. They wanted to loot from Kenyans.
Nobody intended to build a dam, that's your take.
Nobody intended to build a dam. And you know, going forward, I think this country must deal with these issues in a more holistic manner. Because when you let civil servants go and pen this kind of contract, without public debate. Our constitution calls for public participation. We are hearing after the fact that money was wired to Italy, to London, then back to Nairobi. These are people in Nairobi. I wonder what they're investigating. That somebody walked into a bank. You remember a few years ago about the NYS scandal? A young girl, a saloonist, who was walking out of a bank with a sack full of guineas of money, 60 million shillings in one of the transactions. You know, something is not right. We have to put down our foot. But I am happy that the president is saying, we have caught you. I am not happy that some of these people go to court and out. Okay. Like these Italians. These are economic saboteurs. And let's not talk about, like there we are now talking about this Osinde guy. Let's name these people. Let's name them. Let us go after them. He should not, you know, if he is working in the DP's office, I hope he doesn't show up for work today. And I hope the DCI, he should talk. He should be, cross-examined when he is behind bars, because we have to do this for our people.
The argument has always been one cannot step aside before actual conviction. And then there's always the issue of being proven guilty beyond any reasonable doubt. That's where they get away.
Trevor, that is a very bad argument. Mm. Look at the governors. They tell you somebody has looted 2.7 billion shillings and they can't step aside. What are we saying? Do you know Chapter 6 of our Constitution does not only talk about anti-corruption? There is the part of ethics. Who is enforcing that? Why is it conveniently forgotten? I saw the other day an MP in another country had to resign because he stole a sandwich. It is not the price of the sandwich. The MP could afford the sandwich, but he's a thief. The mere fact that he could imagine to steal. He is a criminal. He has a criminal mind. He cannot be in public service. So
except we have a government that's full of criminals.
That is also true, but
that's your assessment.
Is that your assessment, Marilyn?
I mean, what have you just said? You've said that we have people who are accused of crimes, mega crimes, massive theft of public funds. They continue to stay in office. They continue to get the support of their political parties. I would have hoped that you would be speaking about that. Because political parties have a role. Political parties can discipline members. So while we would, as citizens, want people to resign to reflect that the vast majority of Kenyans are not accused of any crime. Most of us are walking around and we don't have crimes following us. So this explanation about, you know, I am innocent, we're not saying you're guilty. We're saying that there are more qualified Kenyans who have no cases to answer, who can hold that position. So, and step aside is not, it's not a legal term. It has no meaning at all. It's either you resign or you're fired. So if it's an appointive office, their process is to remove people. Otherwise, people should be required to resign. And political parties can discipline members.
But the question is, at what point? Because Jakoyo says it's a bad argument, but they've always gone away with that because it's, until you prove it, you can't really tell someone to step aside. And when that floodgate is opened, then as long as any accusation comes your way, then you have to step aside.
But I'm saying now we have a crisis where we have, I mean, do you notice how we're all talking about billions? I don't
Without
even
blinking,
know what a billion looks like. I don't, you know?
0.7% of Kenyans have less than, more than a million in
from
their accounts.
What I've heard.
No, we're told in their accounts. not that not they have access to.
Someone actually did some rough calculations. You can use 50,000 Kenya shillings for, what, 10, 20, 30, 40 years and never hit a billion.
And there are people who don't make 50,000 shillings
yes.
a month.
Yeah, let alone
so
a day.
When we're talking about this, what I'm saying is that there is a, and I think for those of us who are in spaces where we can comment on this, one of the things we need to be is completely intolerant of these arguments. It's not an equal debate. Mm. If we have 4 billion shillings missing, we have a 60, what was that? The 67 or something billion? There was 60, another
63.
One?
3 billion.
63.
Yeah. It's the same.
I mean, even the numbers just, they sort of just mesh up in your brain. We need to be intolerant and we need to stop giving these people space. Well, what we would be saying is, we are not saying you are guilty. However, there is a process that has been initiated. The moment an investigation is initiated and the funds are clearly lost, because the funds are not there, then we need you to resign, or if you are appointed, we need the appointing authority to act. And this soul, this wringing of the hands, oh my God, things are so bad. When people have power, if you can't act, please, then you do need to resign. So we can have people who can act do something. But
who do you
this
believe should act in this case?
So
what are you looking at right now? What are you thinking about?
So which particular case? That's the thing. And that's why I keep dividing between the different cases.
I'll give you a chance to think about it. Let me come to Kiprono now. How much more can our economy take of all these revelations?
Okay, first of all, to speak about the headlines. I mean, the headlines today are just a reflection of business as usual in Kenya. The president has announced it's business as usual on matters of graft. And let me say, on the one hand, you know, there's a lot of public confidence because the agencies of state today look like they're doing something about it. I mean, there's a lot of public confidence in the office of the DCI, in the office of the DPP, in the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Authority. Let me just address the issue of presumption of innocence. You know, in the common law, it is presumed that you are innocent until proven guilty. But I agree with her that there's two things that must happen in Kenya, and it better happen sooner rather than later. Otherwise, what's going to happen is the public is going to think that this is all a charade. We know that there are countries in Latin America where people actually took the law into their hands, where they, if they knew that you were corrupt, they wouldn't wait for you to go through the judicial system. They'll just come to where you are, come to your house, and they will lynch you. And that's the end of the story. I mean, we don't want our country to get there as to a state of lawlessness. I would say two things. One is there must be consequence. And for there to be consequence, the judiciary must really rise to the occasion. I mean, the judiciary must improve its prosecutorial capacity. You see, the standard of proof, the burden rests with he who accuses. And the standard is absolute beyond reasonable doubt. You can only achieve that if you have the best lawyers prosecuting this case. And the DPP has taken a good step forward. I mean, we see people like Philip Burgor and other top lawyers today working with the office of the DPP to prosecute these cases. And the cases must be won convincingly. The second thing that I want to say is, you know, as Kenyans, we must stop being a society where the end justifies the means. Mm. You know, we are going to be the same ones who will go and elect the same people who are being accused here. Why? Because they've got the billions. We must stop that. I mean, people, you're accused today of graft, you're hauled before a court, the next day you're a governor. So what do you expect? I mean, would we expect anything different from the narrative that is unfolding?
Some would say the next day you're appointed.
Absolutely. So for me, I think there has to be consequence. And two, we must change our leadership criteria. And then thirdly, you know, the Constitution is very lenient about arrest and release. I mean, I think we need to, as part of the conversation about a constitutional referendum, we also need to tighten some of those things. I mean, even terrorists, economic saboteurs. If they're arrested and they have billions, and then you have to release them in 24 hours, certainly they'll use their 24 hours to ensure that their cases collapse.
And
so we need those guys. Once they have been accused, they should be sitting in remand somewhere, gathering their evidence with their lawyers.
All right, let's bring in Winnie Ngumi on this. You've been rather quiet. Are we really catching up?
For me, the more important thing is to look at what opportunity we are getting from a business perspective from this kind of scrutiny and discussion. And going forward then, I guess, I am seeing a lot more scrutiny in public investment or in public service delivery. And there lies an opportunity to control graft just by the discussion. Of course, seeing as Kenya is what it is, we know that certain processes will take place, but with this kind of sustained conversation, it means that there will be more people will be more careful. They will not want to increase wastage. They will be more keen. So there is an opportunity in this kind of conversations and a positive that will come out of it.
How difficult, in your view, as someone who runs your own company, is it to operate a legitimate business in this company? Is it difficult? Maybe I'm assuming, as I'm not an entrepreneur myself.
How long do we have?
What do we have?
Well, of course, business is very challenging, but what we find more is because our population is a young population and we don't have role models that are perceived to be ethical and they have put in years of hard work, then it becomes difficult to convince someone on the values of actually hard work and systematically improving themselves and their businesses. Mm-hmm. So that is actually the biggest challenge that we face in business. Of course, we are taxed and we believe that the taxes can be reduced if the if the budget or the economy of the country is controlled
and
the expenditure is controlled. So this whole thing has a ripple effect on business and it makes doing business that much more difficult. Mm. But also the psychological impact on Kenyans when this kind of conversations, you know, talking about billions like it's one shilling. Mm. Why would you want to work hard?
If you can get it through other means.
Yes.
And Marilyn, who should be taking the blame for this, the fight against graft? Who should be taking the lead?
Because okay, so we stop calling it graft sides. And call it theft.
Okay.
Okay.
Who should be taking the lead to fight against
what
theft?
Is the difference?
I think words matter. And I think that the thing is, we've been talking about, I actually think we should start calling it robbery with violence, because it is violent that we are denying people healthcare, that we are denying people education, mm-hmm. that there's going to be a generation of Kenyans. I'm a product of public school education. My children don't go to public school today, but I'm a product of public school education. Mm-hmm. It is possible with a public school education, a good public school education, to do great things, not just in Kenya, around the world. We see people all over the world who came from Kenya public schools doing amazing things. So it is robbery with violence. We are stealing people's health, their education, and their future. And when we call it graft, it just seems like this thing that happens that doesn't have consequences, that doesn't have real life victims. So when you see somebody who is borrowing money for a harambee, for a health harambee, that's the victim of this, you know. So I think for me, there are two people who are particularly responsible. I think the president sets a tone, but it is insufficient in term two. Jubilee operates as if they got elected yesterday and have zero history. And they want us to be ahistorical in how we deal with them, and that's not acceptable. This is the second term. This administration has been promising to act. We had Step Aside came from this administration, mm-hmm. but Step Aside resulted in absolutely no convictions and in no prosecutions. And I take issue with one thing that Kiprono spoke about here, which is the judiciary. The judiciary's role is not to prosecute a case. The judiciary's role is to adjudicate a case. So what we're seeing is weak prosecutions. So a weak prosecution means the case is going to fail. It doesn't matter if that case is heard in 5 days or in 2 years, the case is going to fail. So we need to see significantly more coordination between the arms of government, which means the executive, the judiciary. We need to see the Office of the Director of Public Prosecutions, DCI, working together a lot more and ensuring things like evidence loss, files being lost. I mean, that's ridiculous, you know? So when we see these cases, and then we don't see what are the means that are being taken to secure the evidence, who is working on this case? And I'm not particularly personally impressed by some of the high-flying lawyers that we're calling on board. Because the more we keep having the very same, the usual suspects involved in every single iteration of these, the less likely it is that we're actually gonna get convictions. Because you have somebody who is 1 degree removed from somebody who is accused of a crime. And that's not to say that they are criminal. That is not what I am saying at all. I'm just saying that we want to give ourselves the best shot at dealing with graft, in which case, you know, there are lots of new young lawyers. Partner them. Do open tender. We should not be selectively picking, you know, and we all know what the judicial, the hierarchy is, especially for lawyers. I'm a lawyer by training.
I was about to say that.
Yeah, I mean, it basically means we're going to have 10 men, old men. Maybe that's why your senior counsel.
I want to keep reminding our viewers that they can weigh in on this conversation. 2242 is our SMS line. Use the hashtag Daybreak. To talk to us, I almost said a different name. And in addition to that, you can call in. The numbers will keep scrolling them on the screen.